You're ready, Ruben. Oh, here we go. Okay, we're live. Welcome, everyone. Thanks for coming. I know it's the Sunday after Christmas, and everyone's probably been busy having fun or whatever, getting presents. So just as a reminder to everybody, we're reading the Bible Unearthed by Israel Finkelstein, Neil Asher Silberman, and we covered, or we're going to cover, what we read for this week, which is chapters 8 and 9. And again, the general theme of the book is basically going over the archaeological evidence and how it relates to the era of the Bible, going from the patriarchs, time of the patriarchs up to, well, we're not finished, but I'm guessing it goes up to the end of the Deuteronomistic history, or it could go a little further, I'm not sure yet. But basically that window of time. And like I said, we read 8 and 9, which basically went over 8, continued on with the kind of an archaeological survey dealing with the mid 9th century BC to like the late 8th century BC, and kind of focusing on the Northern Kingdom and comparing that what the archaeological findings are telling us versus the narrative in the Bible, specifically, I think, 1 and 2 Kings. And then chapter 9 talks a little bit more about that and also goes into how the southern kingdom of Judah basically went from a kind of backwater kingdom, if you could even call it that, more of like a, I don't know what you call it, not a kingdom, just kind of like a very sparsely populated, underdeveloped, relative to the north. Anyway, it went from that to a much more developed state after the fall of the Northern Kingdom.
A loose confederacy?
Yeah, you could call it that. And it also touched on the I don't know, I guess you call it like a revolution of Israelite religion at the time, because, well, we'll get into that, but basically major religious reforms happening too. So what do you guys think? You guys want to start with 8? Want to do what we usually do? Go talk about 8, talk about 9?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, what do you guys think of 8? More juicy archaeological data. I can find in my book here.
So I did think it was interesting that Israel was much more significant in every way than Judah at the time during those two centuries. Israel was a significant power. It had a lot more population, fortified cities. Judah had practically nothing. Like you say, it was only a loose federation, no evidence of a strong state power. I thought it was interesting also that Israel was known as a chariot horse for their horses and chariots, especially because, as I recall reading in the Bible condemns horses or putting your trust in horses, and so basically even the use of horses, I thought, was discouraged in the Bible. And so to find that it would, do you recall this? This is my own, this was from years ago, reading in the Bible, but, so
to find in the Bible, but I'm
not Daniel, sure. I can't remember where that's at, but I do remember reading about that before. I think Thomas Thompson brings that up in one of his books early on.
So to find that that was a specialty of the Northern Kingdom was interesting to me. Although, from the way Finkelstein and Silberman put it, it's almost as if anything that the Northern Kingdom did was then reworked and portrayed as a sinful act by the later writers in Judah.
Yeah, that's what I was just going to say. That was one of the themes of the chapter too, was that the history of the Northern Kingdom was kind of theologically reinterpreted in the Deuteronomistic history as in theological terms, basically.
Because it was written from the perspective of the southern...
Right, it was... Right, they're saying during King Josiah's reign, essentially, right? That's their argument.
Yeah.
Yeah, so same thing here. Yeah, that makes sense, Dale. I mean, yeah, if that was a specialty military tactic of the Northerners, it would just be one more characteristic of the North that the Southerners kind of, what would you call it? Said it was sinful. I don't know if they said it was sinful, but, you know.
Well, a lot of things, they were writing from hindsight, so, you know, despite the fact that Israel had a large chariot army, and it also mentioned they had a professional chariot squad or something that had gone out for mercenary right. work and stuff. So, given what happened to Israel in the face of Assyria, that just, like you said, just another aspect of the northern kingdom, and they're turning away from true religion, true worship. And what mm-hmm. happened to them?
Yeah, look what happened. We can't be like that. So yeah, that's the big thing, again, is just the Bible seems to interpret the fall of the Northern Kingdom in those theological terms. Like, they were sinful, they had the golden calves at Dan and Beersheba, and they were idolaters, they practiced pagan rituals, you know, so yeah, they're condemned big time for that. And a lot of the bad things that happened to Israel were chalked up to basically disobeying God's will and a whoring after other gods.
And even when they did kind of try to eliminate most of the Canaanite deities, they still had those nasty bulls that they had erected that they were still worshiping or whatever. So that didn't save them.
Yeah.
Well, I want to go back and add something that I mentioned in a previous Hangout. When we were talking about those two golden bulls, there's also the story in Exodus of them after Moses goes on the mountain to get the Ten Commandments that the Aaron and them make a golden calf. And I was saying that the language in Exodus is actually plural, even though they only show they're making one calf. If you read on, it actually says, talking about that calf, that these are your gods who led you out of Egypt. And it actually says gods plural there in that part. And the verb led is in the plural form of the verb, too.
Yeah, I find that really interesting. So in other words, they're reading the current history back into time, in a sense?
In a way, yeah.
And weren't we also speculating on a possible link between Yahweh and being depicted as a bull? I know we talked about Baal, or Baal, however you say it, being depicted in that way, and a couple other deities from that region, Canaanite deities. But was there a connection to Yahweh? I'm just trying to remember.
Depends on the scholar. Some claim it's Egyptian god, some claim it's Canaanite deities, and some consider that they're making an idol of Yahweh, depicting Yahweh.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what it seems like it's saying in the Exodus account, right? It's meant to be a depiction of Yahweh, right? Because it says the gods that lead, or whatever. I mean, if it's plural, it's plural, but traditionally this is the god that led you out of Egypt, like just like Wayne said, so... I guess it seems like they're thinking of Yahweh. I'm not sure.
That was always my understanding, too. They're worshiping Yahweh or Jehovah in the golden calf.
Okay, gotcha. So another feature of Chapter 8 was kind of going through some of the accounts in the Bible in regards to different events. You know, this is all taking place after the fall of the Amorite dynasty, if you want to call it that. And the Bible kind of attributes that to the revolt of Jehu. And one of the things they mention in the book is that from archaeological sources, namely the Tel Dan Stele and some, they didn't mention specific ones, but they said also from Assyrian sources that it seems actually to have been the fall of the Amorites more likely was due to some conquest into Israel from the Arameans, specifically King Hazael, which is, that's what's depicted on the Tel Dan Stele. So that was another kind of departure between the biblical narrative and what archaeology is telling us. So that was one of the examples. What do you guys think of that? Do you remember that? Were you convinced? I'll take that as a yes.
I wasn't too resistant. I'm probably too easily led by Finkelstein and Silberman.
Yeah.
Same here. I don't have enough background in the archaeology or even the Old Testament history to fairly judge what they're saying.
Mm-hmm. Some of the stuff, too, besides just those two sources, were a lot of the archaeological evidence, too, agrees with that view that it was Aramean conquest. I made some notes here of a couple things. They captured and occupied a large swath of the heartland of the Kingdom of Israel, like a lot of the agricultural fertile land. One of the things they talked about was there was a city gate. I forget which one it was. I think it may have been at Dan, but I'm not sure. But one of the gates had like a canopy structure or feature over the top of it, and they said that that was really a characteristic of Syrian construction, not not something you find in Israelite construction. So again, that's agrees with the idea that it was the Arameans rather than like a revolt of Jehu. The other thing they mentioned was they discovered a stele near the gate of Et Tel, and which they actually thought that may have actually been the site of Bethsaida. But anyway, and it depicted a horn deity, which again was something that is characteristic of the Arameans. And then the last note I remembered was there's ostraca, which they, if I'm saying that right, or ostraca, that's like pottery written on. And a lot of the pottery, almost all the Iron Age II pottery, which is that time period we're talking about, in that region, was written in Aramean. So that's another, again, so you've got all the archaeological evidence seeming to line up with that. So,
well, the big thing that impressed me was overall was the dating, because if you collapse down the dates from the Amorite dynasties and collapse it over to what they're dating as Solomonic and so forth, that a lot of problems disappear about aligning what's in the archaeology with dates. So to me, that was the most interesting and convincing part, because it made sense of the destruction from the Arameans. It also made sense of what the contributions of Omri and his dynasty were. And the only thing I'm wondering is, and I wanted to read further but I didn't get a chance, is how it squares with that period of time up until the Babylonian conquest, you know, because if you've pulled history backwards so that you'd eliminated Solomonic era and placed some of those constructions in Omri's dynasty, that has to in some way lengthen the period of time before the Babylonian conquest. So I'm just wondering how that fits in, how that dating squares with that.
Yeah, in other words, you're having to expand the period. Is that what you're saying?
Right, either that or date the Babylonian incursion earlier somehow. But I'm just wondering how they do it, because I haven't actually read that.
Oh, okay. Well, they do talk about it in here. So, the other thing you mentioned too, yeah, the redating of a lot of this stuff, associating it not with the Solomonic dynasty, which again, there's doesn't seem to be any evidence of a developed kingdom in Judah at the right time. And they said, you know, but there is this these destruction layers in a lot of the northern cities like Megiddo and Hazor and Dan, etc. And they, again, seem to coincide better with Hazael's invasion, which was like 835, I think they said, than it does with Shishak, what the Bible talks about, like the invasion of Pharaoh Shishak in the late 10th century, which was roughly around the time of David and Solomon. So, yeah, that was another thing. That was a big part of the redating, right?
Yeah, that was a major chunk of it.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask you guys a question related to the the statement about the House of David.
Mm-hmm.
It had occurred to me that if these are the what kingdom is it? Hazael's kingdom, of Damascus.
They're Syrians. Yeah, okay. Arameans.
Yeah, so the Aramean or the Syrian kingdom, and they're referring to the northern kingdom as the House of David.
Now, the Steely, yeah.
Now I had already bought into Finkelstein's idea that this whole idea of a united kingdom was a fiction, but I still associated, if there was a David, the House of David was the southern kingdom of Judah. But now this king in the Steely is directing the phrase the House of David to the northern kingdom. And so what are we to make of that? Does this insinuate that possibly if there was a historical David that the northern kingdom believed that they were, that David was part of their kingdom?
Well, remember that he's saying that he killed two kings, Jehoram, son of, and then we don't know, the king of Israel, and then he says, and I killed something something Yahu, son of something something, king of the house of David. So he is mentioning in the Teldan Steli, he's mentioning the killing of two separate kings, one of Israel, Jehoram. They think that's what it means, because it doesn't say, it's messed up. There's, you know, there's a, what do you call that, a lacuna or whatever, a messed up inscription. You can't read it, and it just says Rom or something like that. And then it mentions the other guy, something Yahu, king of, is a king of, or in the house of David.
Got it.
King of the house of David, yeah.
I got it on the screen.
Oh, thanks. Yeah, there you go. Here, can I present you?
Go ahead.
Okay, so they're saying Hazayu, if that's how you say it. Yeah, so there you go.
Okay, I appreciate that. That does explain it. So I didn't realize he also had attacked Judah, but that... Anyway, that clarifies that. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. What's up, Wayman? Good to see you here. Yeah, that was interesting, too, because they don't really... if you guys remember, I don't remember them touching on... When they're talking about the Aramean incursion into Israel, it seems like they don't really talk about this mention on the Steely about Hazael... killing the king of Judah too, the house of David. Do you guys remember them?
No, because
about that part?
When Dale mentioned that, I'm thinking, what? I don't recall that.
Well, remember they had mentioned the house of David thing earlier on in the book, saying, well, you know, maybe since Judah wasn't really a developed kingdom at the time, maybe it's just referring to, you know, some like tribal kings, if you want to call them that, whatever you call them, or chieftains, I think they said, or someone in the Hangout said, probably more like chieftains. But yeah, they didn't really mention that. But, and the other thing I'm wondering too is, like, do we have, I mean, because presumably if they killed the king of the house of David, it would have been in Jerusalem. So did Hazael get all the way down to Jerusalem in his incursion into Israel? I don't know. Wish they would have expanded on that, because I don't remember more. I'll have to look into it. But to be fair, the chapter is kind of focused on the northern kingdom too, so maybe they will go into it. The other interesting thing I remember too was after the Arameans had conquered that big swath of the agricultural zones in Israel, you know, they had basically annexed a few of the cities, and that's where the Tel Dan Stele probably comes from. That was probably erected at Dan under Aramean occupation. And then it talks about how the Assyrians started attacking the Syrians, and that kind of gave the northern kingdom a chance to retake a lot of that captured territory, captured city, rebuild some cities, take back a lot of those cities. And the Bible narrative basically, it mentions that, and it chalks it up to Yahweh remembered the covenant with the patriarchs, with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, essentially. So that part seems right. At least they mention that, you know. But they don't. But the Bible doesn't mention it in regards to, well, really the Arameans had to leave town because they're being attacked by the Assyrians. So. Any comments on all that stuff?
No, that was very interesting. I also wanted to mention Jeroboam II was an interesting figure in the reading. As far as it seemed to me that from what he's saying, that was when the kingdom of Israel reached its pinnacle, when it became reached its greatest power. And I had the impression that Finkelstein thought that maybe some of the things that are credited toward King Solomon and his golden age was really a reframing from the reign of Jeroboam. Is that what you got also? I thought that was interesting.
Yeah, that was interesting. And his son, where it says here that he had one of the longest reigns in history. It's when you're interpreting, the Bible's interpreting from a theological point of view, nothing good could have happened, really, during that period to the northern kingdom. Everything had to be a slide downhill, right? So you kind of almost have to ignore or erase such things like an apparent golden age where they expanded into territories that were kind of conquered by Assyria, and then basically they withdrew, apparently, according to the archaeological record, and then they moved in and reclaimed a lot of territories that formerly belonged to the Arameans.
Sounds a lot like how Fox News describes Obama.
Yeah, I always thought that the Stele was just bragging, and there's a lot of scholars, I remember reading this a while back in BAR and others, who think maybe that it was not the case that he actually killed the king. And there's plenty of Egyptian writings like that too on the temple walls where they make boastful claims to the deities and to the gods about their campaigns that may not necessarily be fully true, but only half truths, in the face of the temple and the people. So some people believe, you know, because that's huge if a king gets killed in Israel, and it would be someplace.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of the ancient inscription contents are probably propagandistic. So the one thing that was really convincing to me, which I think we mentioned a little before you joined, Wayman, though, was a lot of the northern cities like Megiddo and Hazor, etc., they found a lot of Syrian construction at that time, characteristic Aramean or Syrian construction at that time. Like, they found an inscription with a horned deity, which was Aramean, and a lot of the pottery writings from those cities during that time were all in Aramean, and the gates of one of the big cities had like a canopy feature over it, which again they said was characteristic of Syrian construction rather than Israelite construction. So yeah, it's hard to say, but from what they're saying in the book, it seems like there was some kind of Syrian presence in Israel at that time. It's in several cities. And then you also have that destruction layer at mid-9th century BC. So someone obviously went through there and started destroying cities. But yeah, it makes you wonder, like, how much of all this stuff is propaganda. Like you said, we know the Egyptians did it constantly, so. And maybe the part about him killing the king of the house of David is propaganda. Who knows? Yeah, another thing they've talked about too was this quote-unquote golden age, where after the Syrians left because they were being attacked by the Assyrians, they said that they had retaken a lot of these cities, and they said there was like a huge explosion in olive oil production and agriculture in general. And the prophets Amos and Hosea, they're saying that they seem to be condemning like that opulent culture of the Northern Kingdom during the Golden Age, because they had kind of an economic rebirth due to this, you know, them being able to move back into the cities that the Arameans had taken, which I thought was interesting too. And they also mentioned that at the time there was some economic relations between Israel and Assyria at the time. So probably some trade going on, which helped the economic recovery or development, whatever you want to call it. Anyway, that was my main takeaways from chapter 8.
Yeah, it was a long one.
Mm-hmm.
And there was also, towards the end, I think, where it mentioned the strange turnabout where Assyria suddenly started taking a stronger iron fist, iron hand type policy towards its semi-vassal. I don't think, you know, Israel was an actual vassal kingdom, but very powerful. And I'm just wondering, you know, because of all this economic prosperity, it became kind of like a threat to, a lot of those states became a threat to Assyria, so they decided to just go in and just basically turn them into a a police state.
Yeah, that, and it was probably partly military, possible military threat, and I mean, just the attraction of the spoils of war too. You know, whatever motivated conquest at that in that era. You know.
Well, I figure, you know, with the empire, Syria bringing in goods, there's a lot of trade going on. They're getting olive from the Levant and olive oil and stuff like that. So it had to have been a prosperous time for everybody. So what went wrong? You know, why is it suddenly that Assyria needs to just suck these places dry instead of just letting things go as they were, you know?
Yeah, maybe they just, their appetite grew, who knew? Maybe they really started to love olive oil and they couldn't get enough.
Yeah, it could have been just one guy too, you know, who was it, Tiglath-Pileser III was the one.
Yeah.
He just suddenly, maybe he was like Hitler.
And yeah. he was a buffer zone against maybe the Egyptians or some other people who they felt threatened by.
Yeah, another possibility.
Yeah, like he was worried that they would go with Egypt if push came to shove, so they wanted to establish more closer military ties to these states.
Well, that had happened, too, didn't...
Yeah, Hezekiah.
Right. Had tried to ally, or at least that's in the biblical narrative, right? Had tried to ally with the Egyptians against the Assyrians, but didn't quite work out.
It's also interesting that Tiglath-Pileser was, he wasn't from the royal house. So there was a radical break, partially because he had taken over an existing kingdom. He was a governor who overthrew the monarchy, killed the whole royal house, and started his own policy. So it's understandable that it took somebody radical like him to change the way they had done things up to that point.
Oh, so he was an ambitious person anyway, if you can put it in a lightly.
Also significant, I thought, was when I was reading, and they didn't really mention this, but they were just saying what happened was that Assyria basically went to the coast, went down the coast to Egypt, and came back up and attacked Israel, which kind of, to me, tells me just how important Israel was, because they basically had to completely surround it, cut it off from all aid, isolate it, and then conquer it. So to me, that makes it a very important, very powerful state and a big threat to Assyria at that time.
Yeah, and didn't they say he's the one that besieged Samaria, right? Is that him, or was it Shalmaneser the Fifth? I don't remember which one.
I think the latter.
Okay, yeah, because that's when it was really over for Northern Israel, or for Israel, the Kingdom of Israel.
In fact, I thought that was Sennacherib.
During
the time of, according to the biblical story, during Hezekiah's lifetime, well, I'm sorry, you said besieging Samaria. The biblical story says that Sennacherib tried to besiege Jerusalem and failed and went home with their tail between their legs. So I'm sorry, I confused the two.
Oh, no problem.
Because it does say after Tiglath-Pileser III died, came Shalmaneser V, who immediately embarked on a campaign of liquidation. He reduced the countryside around Samaria and laid siege to the city itself. After a long siege, the city was stormed, and at least part of its surviving population was marshaled off to concentration points from which they were eventually resettled in distant Assyrian domains.
And looks like possibly may have been Sargon II who saw it through.
Yeah, it says he delivered the coup de grace.
Yeah. From Sargon's Chronicles that we... Could you go back up?
Yeah.
That we have the fullest Assyrian account of what transpired, yeah.
Yeah, again, it mentions chariots.
Yeah, that was a big thing with Northern Kingdom. Specialists in chariot combat.
I'm wondering here where he says, I formed a unit with 200 of their chariots from my royal force. I was wondering if it was just the chariots, or did he actually include the charioteers?
I think he included the charioteers. I think he basically pressed Israelite charioteers into the service of his military.
In fact, he made it sound as if Israel was unique in that sense, because they had their own... He allowed them to have their own fighting unit, instead of filtering them within the troops of the rest of the Assyrians, he let them fight together.
Yeah, I thought that was interesting. So yeah, did you guys have anything else on 8 that you found interesting, or any passages you wanted to read, or really anything at all from that chapter that you wanted to talk about? You guys want to move on to chapter 9?
Sounds good. Yeah, I'm just overwhelmed with it and having trouble taking it all in and remembering all the details.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah,
I need a better chart of all the archaeological evidence, and you know, a couple notes on each on the reasons for dating it when he wants to date it. You know, and then maybe that in a separate column with an actual, you know, reconstructed history of the region.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he does have that. I think it's on page.
Yes, tables here and there, but they're all broken up in, you know, different things on different tables. It'd be nice to see a more unified chart of everything.
Yeah.
Like a wall chart or a poster size chart or something.
Yeah, this one was helpful to me on pages 236 and 237, Judahite kings from Rehoboam to Ahaz, because it talks about like the biblical narrative and then extra biblical evidence. So that was kind of nice just to get a feel for who was ruling when and what happened, to give you that broader picture like you're talking about.
Yeah, too bad this version isn't still in a table format.
Oh, I didn't know that.
It's a homemade one.
Yeah.
Someday maybe I'll go back and do it.
Yeah. I'm just trying to flip through 8 and make sure there's nothing important that we skipped over.
Is Dale still listening?
Is he?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Did you see in the side chat, I found the verse you were asking about in the beginning of the Hangout regarding the horses?
Oh, thank you. Good. Only he must not acquire many horses for himself or cause the people to return to Egypt.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, the bull shrines were at Dan and Bethel, right? Not Beersheba.
Yeah,
Dan and Bethel. Yeah, okay. I think I said Beersheba. My mistake.
I did find it interesting that he pointed out that all the kingdoms of Israel were considered evil in their opinion. And so they would try to attribute any failure as a result of God's judgment, but even when they succeeded, they would still never say it was because they had... Basically, it was just because God showed mercy. Like, he felt sorry for them, and so he showed mercy.
That's where he said that God was remembering the covenant he had made with Abraham.
Right.
Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So he's kind of laying off a little bit, you know, when it seemed like there had been good fortune for the northern kingdom.
That's something I have a lot of questions about, but I don't know how to really phrase them or put them as good questions to ask. But the relationship between the Deuteronomic history and the other narratives in Genesis, because some scholars think, you know, like the Exodus story was written later, and like, you know, some of the stories in the patriarchs are written later. So the fact that the Deuteronomic history refers back to those events, I'm just not sure the chronology of the writing. I mean, when he refers back to the patriarchs there that you just talked about, I mean, was that really a tradition they knew at that time when the Deuteronomic history was written?
I think it happened later what some of those people who try to pull out that tangled web of Christmas lights, if you will, to separate it out, they believe that Deuteronomistic history runs from Deuteronomy to 2 Kings. And when they had the issues with Assyria in the north, a lot of people integrated back down into Israel, either fleeing or taking those texts. And then they tried to put it in unified form due to the loss of the kingdom in Assyria, to try to save some of that history and mesh it together. They were harsh to the north because being taken over by a nation and being ruled means that, you know, you've heard it tons of times, like all through Isaiah, you know, oh, it must be we sinned or we did something else. It's, you know, it's got to be our faults if the divine, or if God says, you know, be ruled, our territory is ruled by somebody else. That's the worst thing that could happen to them, is have the Holy Land that was given to them, you know, ruled by somebody else. So at that destruction, like, there's absolutely nothing once they're assimilated. And probably the only thing we have out of that time period is Tobit. But a lot of the prophets like Hosea, Amos, like they're saying here, it was huge markers on what not to do in the south. And even though, like, they felt bad for them, it was like, hey, you know, this is what happened to these guys. You know, you guys better watch out. So the history is so mixed, especially in, like, 1 and 2 Samuel. All that is all tangled up. If you take, say, example from, like, the Dead Sea Scroll Bible, and you see the number of veins running through that, you have, like, the David cycle, Saul cycle, the Solomon cycle, all kinds of stuff in there. You can see, like, this kind of meshing of the north and south, and it may have been, you know, to preserve. That's their theory of it anyways. You know, I'm not saying that that's the way it happened, but that's who people like Friedman and all those other people, you know, who thought about it, are saying.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand and follow what the logic is there. I mean, it seems to me, like going back to an example we had earlier about the two golden calves that were made, I think the story in Exodus about them creating a golden calf after the Exodus was retroactive to that. I mean, basically, just saying, hey, here's a story where saying, hey, you've been warned long ago not to do this. But I think that story was fabricated during that time when those two golden calves that we're talking about in Samuel the Kings were being made. And so when they talk other things about the promises made to the patriarchs and things, I mean, I think the promises themselves are all fabricated at that same time. So the way they refer back to them just seems odd to me.
Yeah, I'm thinking that, you know, sorry, go ahead, Dale.
Well, I definitely feel what Wayne is saying, and I felt it when we were discussing the chapter dealing with with basically whether Israel was ever in Egypt, you know, on the Exodus account, because I brought up Amos and Hosea at that time, who specifically referred to the Exodus and the wandering in the wilderness, and I thought, how is it at this early stage do they seem to be aware of such a thing if this was a story that was created later on, you know?
Exactly.
Similar to what Wayne is saying, yeah.
Are you guys saying that the stories, like in Genesis and Exodus, were created after, like, King Josiah's time? Is that what you're saying?
That's what I'm asking, whether that makes sense or not.
I'm thinking that it ran parallel. The two histories ran parallel. It was meshed together in one text. After all that, when they tried to preserve the literature, so you had two priestly castes because you had two temples at the time, one in the north and one in the south. They believe that literature probably needed to be preserved. This is what some people like in BAR say and all that. So, you know, it was kind of like a meshing together because they believed it should be. So if it looks like it's meshed together, it probably is. And like you were saying before, where it appears that they later went in and said, you know, earlier times reflect later events on the political situation and what's going on. Some even think that, say, the speech of Solomon on why a king would be, I mean, Samuel, on why a king would be such a bad idea, you know, is reminding them in this time of Solomon when they were thinking about integrating him with nations for trade reasons, and he had all the wives and everything. And, you know, maybe that was a speech put in. You know, things like that. It's a mess. It's a big fun mess, though.
Yeah, I kind of look at it that way, too. Like, you know, you have the northern traditions coming into Judah after the Assyrian conquest, and then you have Josiah and his priests finding Deuteronomy, this lost book, and it seems like you said, they're blending together the northern traditions with the southern, and then redacting all that stuff, and then adding on this whole Deuteronomistic history section, which is kind of giving a generalized reinterpretation of everything that came before. So you're getting editing in that old stuff, and then this later stuff, which is meant to supersede everything that came before it.
So when do you picture, just to make sure I get this clear in my mind, when do you picture Genesis and Exodus being created? Because I somehow thought that they were created during the exile in Babylon.
That seems late to me, but I don't know enough about it. That seems, I mean, totally created, possibly not written down till then or something, I don't know, but the traditions at least seem like they have an older pedigree than that.
Yeah, it seems to me like the J text especially has a continual narrative early on that makes good sense as an interesting story, but didn't have the propaganda element into it yet. I mean, the idea of God giving promises and stuff, I think that was interpolated into that story later on in order to make it more apt to like Josiah's time.
And if it's all exile or post-exile, why doesn't it all look like the priestly source, you know? It seems like you've got different streams coming from different eras being brought together. Maybe not written text, but stories, you know, and again, not to harp on it, but I think Gunkel's ideas are valid too, that you've got stories that exhibit more primitive forms and then stories that exhibit more later developed forms. So I don't know, I think you've got a lot of different stuff coming together. When it was actually written down, I couldn't say.
Maybe
go ahead, sorry.
Oh, I was just going to say maybe it's better for me to think in terms of them putting together these different sources during the exile, possibly.
I would say that. I would say that that's a pretty good assumption, because when you're in exile and you're being assimilated by a different country, you want to preserve everything you can about yourself so you remember. And you want to compile a national epic to pass forward to people who might survive it. And so, you know, you start collecting and putting things in. So all these veins could be copies of copies of copies that could very well come from priestly lines that are, in fact, much older. But by the time you get to the Babylonian period, it's all put together or starting to be put together. But it's continually put together, with the events that are happening and things like that, using what they call Pesher. You know, they even did it in Dead Sea Scrolls, predicting, you know, reading into literature what's political events that are happening and interpreting text that way. It's a constant building. And then by time, you know, they had the whole Torah or the whole national history or the Deuteronomistic history, but then again, you know, that could just be that too is a hypothesis, you know. Just some are better than others.
The one thing I hold out for that is like the thing with about Ezra, you know, that they lost everything and he, what did it say, it was all re-revealed to him or something weird like that. I forget exactly what it seems like there was some kind of compiling thing with Ezra happening. Some hint of that. Anyway. Yeah, maybe for one of our upcoming Old Testament books we can read something that's dealing with theories on when these texts were compiled, written, how old some of the traditions are, etc.
Well, related to that and related to chapter 9, well, I think it's interesting the way he summarized the fact that he feels the Bible is misrepresenting history in the sense of trying to say that at one time Israel worshipped Jehovah exclusively, and then they became unfaithful and started, as you say, whoring after the nations, or going, that is, worshipping their gods. And he's trying to say this was actually the common practice for the peoples to worship several gods. Jehovah was just one of the gods they worshipped. And sometimes Jehovah was worshipped along with, as a mixture with other gods, as if he had a consort, Asherah, and so forth. But only at the time of Hezekiah, basically, shortly after the northern kingdom is taken away and this influx of people from the northern kingdom comes down, and suddenly Judah becomes a powerful nation for the first time ever. It seems to want to enforce its will on a single devotion to Jehovah alone, and wants to finally destroy the high places, for example, you know, something that no one previous to that had done. That he feels is an is proof that this is the first time this ever happened. And so it makes me wonder, the reason why I want to tie that, I found that interesting on its own, but I also want to tie it in with the question of sources, and because I'm wondering then, if before that, Israel or Judah was never uniquely devoted to Jehovah, then I wonder if these sources that came from previously, as we read them, they're all an account of Jehovah's unique dealings with Israel and Judah. I'm wondering if that was doctored up, if the accounts per se were would reflect a plural many gods, a relationship with many gods in the original sources. Do we have any indication of that? Or
I find that very plausible. Just looking at like the account of the Garden of Eden story in Genesis, the story as we have it doesn't give much detail on who the serpent is. But it seems like just based on what we know of ancient traditions, you know, and we know that Israel worshipped serpents at other times and things, that it seems like that serpent actually had been a god who was, you know, who Yahweh was in conflict with in the garden in a way, but the other god had helped man gain the knowledge that man needed, even though Yahweh didn't like that. But later on, it was re-edited to make it just a mere creature.
Same thing with Moses putting up the staff in the wilderness, the snake that was supposed to be not Leviathan,
Nehushtan?
Yeah, Nehushtan, yeah. Yeah, it makes you think a lot of these stories probably had a bunch of different origins and then were brought together into a singular tale. You know, and it would make sense a lot of the, like you said, some of the funny details of the stories and
yeah, like say for example, one of really good example of this is when reading Joshua and Judges. That account supports a national army coming in, totally wiping everything out. But by the time you get to you know, certain sections of Judges, and then 1 and 2 Samuel, you see all these loosely knit tribes trying to come together into a tribal league. But like even the Song of Deborah, which is probably one of the oldest pieces of literature in the Old Testament, shows that some of these tribes would come to Holy War and wage war against the Sea Peoples and others, and some of them wouldn't show. Right. So it almost like when Joshua said, choose you this day who you will serve, as for me and my tribe, or me and my house, we will serve Yahweh. So, you know, that's saying, all right, there's tons of tribes. It might be El, it might be Elohim, it might be Yah, it might be, you know, whoever it would be. And then, you know, then you get duality. coming in with Elohim, Yahweh Elohim, the Lord God, kind of like, you know, out of Egypt, Amun-Ra, kind of like that kind of stuff. But at the same time, they needed to unite in order to self-preserve themselves in the tribal league. So when King Saul, he becomes king, you know, according to the biblical literature, in this line of thought, he splits up the heifer, sends it to the tribes. You know, that's saying, you better show, because if you don't show, we're going to come looking for you after this is over with. You know, it's pretty amazing how they almost forced him into it, both ritualistically and religiously and with the military. So now, you know, if you don't show, you're no longer protected. And if you're saying you're not with us, you're against us, and we're going to come find you. And that's what they did with the tribe of Benjamin after the handmaiden was slain. Maybe somebody can look that up. I can't remember the exact reference. But they cut her up into 12 pieces, and they sent her to the 12 tribes. And the tribe that didn't show was the tribe of Benjamin. And the thinking is that this is a hit on King Saul politically, because, you know, King Saul was from that tribe. They didn't show. They were almost wiped out. They were complaining that they didn't have enough women to procreate, lest the whole tribe be wiped out. That's pretty serious stuff. And that reflects, you know, this forced cohesion that needed to happen for their very survival within the literature.
By the way, not only was Saul from that tribe, he was actually from the very city, Gibeah, that committed that horrible sin. So that definitely, to me, shows it was a direct attack on Saul.
Yep.
Yeah, that is interesting. Yeah, makes you... Sean, the last time, I think it was last time, maybe two hangouts ago, you know, the narratives of what's happening in Canaan between Judges and Joshua are so different. And Shauna had just kind of off the cuff was speculating, you know, maybe Joshua, the book of Joshua is like, and Joshua himself is meant to be like propagandistic fictional history and actually meant to basically be King Josiah, trying to basically unite all of Israel into one Jerusalem-centered state, essentially. And I'm trying to find it on her Facebook page, but she found a book by some scholar, I can't remember his name, who actually was making that argument too. And I wanted to read that little passage she cited from the book, but I can't find her post on it, but I thought it was an interesting idea.
When we had discussed it, I had also pointed out that I had read, I wish I knew who it was, but I had read also someone that's saying that they felt that Joshua was patterned after Josiah and his desire to want to conquer or take over the northern territory. In other words, they had a right to it now. Basically, they're one people. And the whole Deuteronomic history is trying to say that we were one people in the beginning, so we have a right to unify. That property belongs to us, and so it ennobled him to want to conquer that territory, and that Joshua, the figure of Joshua is patterned after Josiah, in a sense.
Right, and then there's that thing, I forget where it is, I think in one of the prophecies of one of the prophets, I want to say Elijah, maybe it was one of the other, I can't remember who it was, but one of a member we talked about a couple hangouts ago too talked about prophesying the coming of a great king, Josiah, which I can't remember where that was. If any of you guys remember, that'd be awesome. But anyway, that's the other theme of this whole book is they're arguing for. Well, I can't quite pin down exactly what they're saying in regards to all the details, but they're definitely arguing for the writing of like Deuteronomy and all that block of Deuteronomistic history during the reign of King Josiah. Because, like, it said at least, too, that you know, in the earlier books when it's talking about some of the stories in Genesis and Exodus, a lot of it seems to be dealing with concerns or mentioning things that really didn't actually happen, like some of the anachronisms of camel domestication and stuff like that. A lot of the stuff seems to be characteristic of that 8th century, late 8th century time period. Well, actually, am I getting the 8th century mixed up?
By the way, Doug, you see the text I put in the sidebar, the 1 Kings 13, too? That's the text you're thinking about?
Yeah. And the man cried against the altar by the word of the Lord and said, O altar, altar, thus says the Lord, behold, a son shall be born to the house of David, Josiah by name, and he shall sacrifice, blah, 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 blah. So, yeah. So that's a big thing. Like, of course, Josiah found all these texts, and oh, what do you know? It predicts my reign. What a coincidence. And I got I did get the centuries mixed up. It was 7th century, not 8th. Sorry about that. But yeah, a lot of the stuff, even in the stories of Genesis, Exodus, etc., seem to be describing characteristics of that of the 7th century rather than the ostensible time that these stories are taking place in. And also, interestingly, you know, and maybe these other guys who argue for post-exilic compilation have different arguments too, but it at least they're saying that it really fits, all that stuff really fits nicely into the 7th century. I forget some of the details, but we've talked about them before.
Right, I remember that. So, anyway, I feel bad that I even mentioned the exile, because as you said, I was convinced also that the 7th century seemed to fit, everything seemed to fit the 7th century. It, like, had the fingerprint of the 7th century all over it. And so, it seems hard to think that unless, again, you want to say these were traditions that came earlier, but that they were put in writing for the first time in the 7th century.
That's what I think they're trying to say. You know, like, I wouldn't be surprised if it was all oral and none of it was really written down, or at least not officially on in the form of the text that we have inherited in the 7th century.
I think you should reread, like, the end of chapter 6, like the last couple pages.
In this book?
Yeah, because it gives like a summary of why Josiah is so important, even when they're discussing dates that are putatively in the 10th century, whether it's
right.
A prophecy about Josiah, you know, retrojected back to that time. So it goes into some detail about why, because Josiah was kind of like a new David for the writers then.
Yep. And, you know, some of the stuff in the Exodus narrative, yeah, well, I'm not going to keep going over, but yeah, like you said, a lot of fingerprints of 7th century concerns in there. Not just in the Deuteronomistic history. So yeah, Dale segued us nicely into chapter 9, so what do you guys think of their argument that Yahweh worship wasn't really the singular traditional religion of either the Judaites or the Israelites, but that was a later development, and then what we're reading about at that time in the Bible is actually a retrospective look. I thought it was really convincing, and then obviously, I mean, we've all probably come across it before, that evidence of polytheistic practice, pagan practices in all those regions up to and even after Josiah's reign, Hezekiah's reign.
Yeah, it seems eminently plausible to me. So, I don't really know how to properly weigh the evidence for it, but it's what I would expect to be the case.
Yeah. And one of the key things arguing in 9, too, is that, and Dale touched on it, Judah doesn't really show any signs of being like a condition of like full blown developed statehood until 200 years after Solomon lived or would have lived, and obviously, you know, Solomon temple, all that stuff, no evidence for it. So yeah, this is really when it seems like Judah's kind of coming into being a full-blown kingdom of significance. And the other thing they mentioned too, which kind of backs it up, was they said there was a bunch of cuneiform tablets, but specifically six of them from the Egyptian town Akhtaten, which is Tel El Amarna. They like talk about Jerusalem, or they spelled it in the old form, the Bronze Age spelling, with a U, Urusalim, as say like quote a thinly settled highland region loosely supervised from the royal citadel.
Those tablets are a good read. I'm glad you brought that up. When we were talking about that, I was about the other steel. Like I was going to mention that, like, you know, that whole list of tablets are a really good read.
Yeah, do they have like a specific name? Are they the El Amarna tablets, or are those the Amarna letters, or that's what those are, right?
Yeah, I think some of them were, if I remember correctly, it's been a while since I read them, were like messages going back and forth for like supplies and permission to do certain things and.
Right, exactly, yeah.
Yeah, one of the letters was written by Abdi Hiba, the king of Jerusalem. So it's one of the Tel El Amarna letters.
Right, yeah. Another interesting thing they talk about, too, is, you know, they give you the general picture that religious practice in Judah during this time was, like, very highly varied and basically decentralized. There was no centralized Yahweh cult at the time. But this is before, like, this is just post-Omride, basically, or even during, probably. And they found boatloads, and this is in Israel and Judah, of, like, clay fertility figurines, incense altars, libation vessels, offering stands, tons of these different ritual sites and you know, like I said, figurines, all sorts of stuff that is just a big testament to what religious practice was actually like during that time, as opposed to what the Bible's describing, where it was really just a backsliding against the original, quote-unquote, Yahweh-only worship. So I thought that was pretty convincing, too. You know, you get all this weird pagan iconography and all sorts of weird altars and figurines strewn all across Israel, you know, dating from this time period.
I also like the fact that he selects Hezekiah's reign as the beginning of this Yahweh-only worship goes hand in hand. He didn't talk about it, but Isaiah, among the prophets, Isaiah usually is cited as the first among the prophets that has this attitude that Jehovah is the only God, and he makes fun of then anyone who worships gods that they make from their hands, you know, like half of it. He cuts down a tree. Half of it he makes into a god, and half of it he burns in the fire, as if the one part was sacred and somehow better than the other part.
And is that from Isaiah or Jeremiah?
No, that's Isaiah.
That is Isaiah? Okay, I was wondering about that a couple weeks ago. I couldn't remember. Thank you. Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Basically, that was my point, is that it seems to go hand in hand. This is the very first time you start seeing that sort of talk, as opposed to before that we have, you know, I think is usually best talked about as henotheism, which acknowledges that other gods existed, which also ties in with the question of, again, when was Exodus, when were the Ten Commandments first written, for example, the covenant? Because it actually says, as Dr. Price has often pointed out, you know, you must have, I'm the God that brought you out of the land of Egypt, you must have no other God before me, so it presumes that there are other gods, but I'm supposed to come first because they didn't bring you out of Egypt, I did. And so this would indicate that that text was created before the time of Hezekiah.
And then there's that weird, I forget where this comes from, but that weird thing too where, I'm not going to remember the locales of any of the characters, but one of the kings, someone is wanting to worship, he gets converted to worship Yahweh, but he's like the helper of his king from his land.
Naaman the leper.
Yeah, exactly, and he wants to take some of the soil of the Holy Land with him so he can worship Yahweh. Like, there's some connection to this, to the soil itself and being able to worship Yahweh.
I think also with the questions of when some of these texts were written, that we can look at how they describe God, not just where they're talking about, you know, one God or many, but a lot of polytheistic religions, gods are in more anthropomorphic terms. But when you get into a stronger monotheism, God has more power to himself and he's in more in transcendental terms. So when we see stories, you know, of God wrestling with Jacob physically and stuff, that seems to come from a time where God's been spoken of in anthropomorphic terms, which is probably a more polytheistic time. But I think those stories have all been redacted in order to make them fit better with monotheism.
Yeah, and that sort of stuff and the stuff that Gunkel brought up when we were going over Hermann Gunkel's book, that sort of stuff just screams old to me, you know. So that's the one thing. I don't know if any scholars do argue this. I could be misrepresenting the argument, but aren't there some that say basically all this stuff was essentially created out of whole cloth during the exile or post-exile, or just that it was merely compiled and heavily redacted during that time? I don't know, but but if there are any arguing that it was all just basically created out of whole cloth during this time, I don't buy that at all. It just seems crazy, given the given the real primitive conception of God and other stuff from some of these stories.
God evolves through the text in a strange way that doesn't make sense if the text is off of one time period.
Yeah. Well, before we keep going, I've got a bunch of notes on chapter 9, but I want to. Did you guys? I mean, we've already gone through some of the stuff, but any other guys have like any general thoughts on chapter 9? No, it's kind of late. We're already kind of into it, but
no, I'm good. I'd just like to hear your summary of it, because I'm still a little overwhelmed with all the book, all the details he throws in.
Yeah,
I'd like to hear what you have to say.
Well, I just have a few little notes. I mean, what's the last one we talked about? Oh, yeah, the figurines and stuff like that. And then this was something you had mentioned already, but I wrote down too, that even in the Book of Kings, I don't remember if it's 1st or 2nd Kings, but it talks about how, you know, their high places were not taken away. So probably referring to these non-Yahweh-based, quote-unquote, pagan ritual sites. So, and now I think it was during during the reigns of these kings who were aggressively Yahweh only, basically. Even during their reign, their high places were not taken away. And they're arguing too, like these practices were not isolated deviations from like a standardized, centralized, Jerusalem-based Yahweh cult, but they were these really varied religious practices were really the, like, the traditional, long, you know, going way back religion umbrella term, if you will, of basically Canaanites, I guess you could say, and then eventually Israelites.
See, that's the thing I sometimes wonder about, you know, like, the two options of, you know, they came in as an army, killed everybody off and settled, or they kind of streamed in and assimilated the people that were there. What we're saying right now would seem to be the latter, that they assimilated the people that were there. So they were tolerant of the belief systems to a certain point. They allowed them to do things. They allowed them to have both the Yahweh cult and the Canaanite cult be mixed, because, you know, we see it in the letter, in the archaeology and in the text. So then, you know, after the conservatives came in and certain sections of, you know, Yahweh cult fundamentalism, if you will, like more conservative priests and kingly caste, priestly caste, you know, came in, and then they forced assimilated those who were still hanging on the outside and had mixed, because I believe they were worried about assimilation themselves, into, you know, back into Canaanite ideas, forced them to come forward and accept, you know, the Yahweh cult. So I don't know, that just seems like what may be happening, where they said, you know, look, there's this whole mixture, there's this cultural integration here that we cannot simply tolerate. You know, it either needs to be A or B, clearly. And so, you know, like, the more conservative side of that was, well, let's do a forced assimilation, let's knock down all the groves, let's, you know, grind up all the altars and get that Canaanite influence out of there and have what we believe is a pure Yahweh cult, because in the long run, that'll be better for us. You know, that's probably what the priestly caste was saying. So I think, like, you know, originally, like I was saying, they probably came in and they were tolerant at first, and then had this huge reformation for some reason to cleanse all this stuff out and to force assimilate the population to the Yahweh cult.
Did you have something to say, John?
It's like, to me, an evolutionary kind of thing where, as Judah began to become more powerful and organized after the fall of the Northern Kingdom, that they, you know, still had to, the elite, the kings, the priests, still had to reign and control with the will of the people, who, from what the text is saying, were pretty syncretistic with other cults, different gods, and all kinds of stuff. So as they became more powerful, that's about the only time you can actually impose a certain way of thinking upon a kingdom, is when somebody like Hezekiah, who was stood out in the Bible as somebody that had the power and wherewithal. But there was a growing movement of this Yahweh only, that they describe it. And I didn't know Morton Smith coined that term, but apparently he did. And once they became powerful enough, they could then impose their own forms of worship that were developing at the capitals, or capital, Jerusalem, over the rural peoples, who up until then were given a free hand. Otherwise, there would have been trouble. But you need a very powerful state in order to do something like that.
Yeah. I also see this whole process, and specifically this reform happening at the time of Hezekiah and Josiah, as really just the culmination of this long process, where, you remember, we talked about the archaeological evidence of how it seems like the Israelites as a people kind of came into being. Like, they didn't come, doesn't seem like they came in as foreigners into this land and conquered. Really, they were Canaanites, and eventually because of geographic reasons mainly, kind of developed a separate identity. And this whole process is I see it as like a solidifying of a unique and distinctive identity. You know, they're contending with all these Canaanite practices, but this is their history too. I mean, at this time, obviously, they're probably not thinking that it is because it's hundreds of years ago. But I just see this whole process, and maybe it only makes sense when you're looking at it in hindsight. Maybe it, you know, it's probably more messy than that. It wasn't this nice, neat, gradual process. But that's kind of how I'm seeing the whole thing. Like, you have just Canaanites. Eventually, you get these pastoral groups. Eventually, developing their own identity, they're becoming Israelites. The Yahweh worship becomes like a dominant god, and it slowly gets more and more dominant. And then once it kind of gets intertwined with the political structures, then it gets even more dominant. And then Northern Israel gets destroyed, and King Josiah is coming along, and he's trying to unify all these territories. And what's a great tool for doing that? A centralized religious cult. So boom, now Yahweh worship, which is probably already dominant form in that region, becomes the official quote-unquote religion. And yeah, I just see that as a big, long development.
Yeah, it's always a power play too, that, you know, Syria did it, Persia did it, is to impose a unified form of organization, religion, what have you.
Right.
From a sociological standpoint, I find the different possible strategies here, though, to be kind of interesting. I mean, we're talking here about the strategy of trying to wipe out competing cults and stuff, you know, destroying their altars and high places and things. What we can compare that, you know, later on to like the Catholic Church, the way it dealt with a lot of pagan cults, by incorporation, by making their practices into Catholic practices. Like the way it adopted Christmas and Easter and a lot of saints and stuff. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, it's almost like a continuum of which strategy they could use. So I'm wondering how much in the Old Testament has actually been incorporated, but they make us think it's always been part of Yahweh worship from the beginning. I mean, like, are things like the Ark of the Covenant, you know, originally from, like, other cults or something that got switched
like
over
from Egypt?
Also
the high places worship too, that, you know, the Temple of Jerusalem itself is a high place. It's the official high place now.
Yeah.
But other forms of worship are going on mountains and things.
But what what kind of determines, you know, on the circumstances of which strategy is going to get used? I mean, why would they pick a strategy of trying to wipe out the competing cults instead of trying to, you know, to change the competing cults into being Orthodox, if that makes sense?
Well, it may have been like a two-pronged approach, like you're saying. It may have been
that's pretty good, Wayne. I think one indication of that would be in the Song of Deborah, where she sits and prophesies under a sacred oak. You know, here, you know, it's like, wait a minute, you know, it's actually is being absorbed and included, and all of a sudden it becomes, so what exactly are you purging? It's just probably the blatant, you know, the blatant stuff that you would want to, the more modern blatant practices, you know, but all the older stuff is now assumed that it was original. It's pretty amazing.
Yeah.
I'm curious, on this topic, do you ever see, I guess I find myself questioning whether it's helpful even to think in terms of Israel as a distinct people from the Canaanites, because as you said, I already think of them as Canaanites, and I think of, can we ever think of a time when we have Israel separated? Like, once they formed themselves into a kingdom, do we have any more Canaanites, or did they really combine all? It was just a federation of Canaanites, the tribes of Canaanites, and once they formed themselves into these two kingdoms, a southern and a northern kingdom, there are no other Canaanites out there.
Yeah, I think like you
Moabites,
said,
Ammonites.
Yeah, there were these groups that didn't kind of get taken into the fold, if you will, and that was probably happening. Once the Israelites got their own identity, you had assimilation going on. Probably other groups being brought in, you know, because they're the same people if you go back. But eventually, you probably had too, like you're saying, Moabites and Ammonites and people who who didn't really want to integrate, and maybe they did get wiped out, I don't know, or died out, or maybe eventually they did get integrated, who knows.
I like the idea of making comparisons to other societies just in order to see the sociological factors that are in place. So I'm curious, just on a side note here, if anybody knows, how did the Netherlands become, you know, a separate culture from France and Germany? I mean, how did that evolve into them being separate?
You know, I'm not sure. I'm not good on that history there.
Could have been lines drawn on a map. After
or, are there other examples you are more familiar with that would shed some light on the sociological, you know, operations here?
I'm trying to think of ones that they're still all sharing, like, a general geographic area. I mean, I'm sure there's, like, zillions of them everywhere. I'm just none that I'm super, you know, up to snuff on.
I heard of a country where there's 50 different states and they united them into one.
Yeah. Well, obviously, I mean, Europe itself went through that, you know. Just that's, if you go back far enough, Europe itself basically developed in that way. You get all the different ethnic groups, and eventually you get, you know, they're distinctive enough to where there's them, and then there's everybody else, and then you start to get different territories popping up. So, yeah, I mean, that just happens everywhere all the time. And I think we're dealing with the same thing here. And there's politics mixed in with the whole process, too, obviously, I think. So
do you think that this, I guess, somewhat goes back to then the book of Joshua, probably. Well, and each is describing a situation in which each tribe didn't fully take over, didn't completely wipe out all the Canaanites in its region, and I think Finkelstein said that Judah was the only tribe to have actually done that.
Right.
What exactly do you see going on there? Do you think then that, do you think that it, I guess I want to know, what's the real history of this situation? Did, by the time, were they actually a nation at the time when there was separate Canaanite nations, at the time when Israel was a nation, you could also say the Jebusites had their own separate kingdom, and the, you know, I'm trying to think of the list of all these, you know, the you know, there's a long list that includes the Jebusites.
Yeah.
Hittites.
Ammonites. Hittites. Yeah, exactly.
Although, of course, the Hittites, anyway, that's a whole other ball of wax, because it seems like how I've never fully understood when I came to realize that the Hittites, I don't even know if we should put them in the list of this, of a Canaanite people group, because they were this giant empire. But the Bible somehow does include them. I don't understand why.
Yeah, they're definitely not Canaanites. They're from, like, Turkey, basically. They're Near Eastern.
So what's your understanding of that? Why would... See, that seems to be an important clue. What's going on? Why would they include the Hittites in that list of Canaanites if everyone knew that they weren't Canaanites at all?
Well, my guess is that Canaanites was kind of an amalgamation category, more of a category of inclusion rather than exclusion. And it was just a lot of different population groups around them. And there was, like, this umbrella term, Canaanites. But it wasn't the only, you know, not every foreigner was a Canaanite, but probably a big collection of different groups were put under that term, Canaanite. And that's essentially still how we use the term, I mean, when we're referring back to this time period. I mean.
There's also some people speculate it was just a scribal mistake and they meant Hivites.
That's interesting.
But that means they would have to have been aware of Hittites when they were writing.
Yeah. I'm trying to look over my notes again. Basically, the increasing power and importance of Judah as a kingdom really seemed to be a result of the Assyrian conquest of the north. Yeah, we talked about that. Refugees from there. And they talk too about archaeological evidence for like a really sudden, we're talking over the course of a few decades, population growth specifically, and especially in Jerusalem. You've got Jerusalem itself going from, I think they said, like a few acres to like 20 plus acres in the course of a few decades. You've got a huge increase in farming settlements in the areas surrounding Jerusalem. You're starting to get monumental inscriptions, trading seals and trading seal impressions. You're getting royal ostraca, which again is that like a pottery writing essentially for royal administration. You're getting mass production of pottery for trading. And remember, too, at this time, this is when Judah is actually having an economic relationship with other empires, too. So, and then you got development of, they talked about, too, like the tombs, the burials started to get more elaborate and expensive. People even carving tombs into the rock cliffs and hillsides or whatever in Jerusalem. I'm trying to think of the other things, too.
One thing that kind of confuses my mind a bit reading this, I just need to reread the biblical story itself more and maybe reread the archaeology more, but the question of whether Israel and Judah were even friends or foes, because it talks about battles between them quite a few times, and there being so much conflict, you know, with political strategies and stuff that it almost seems odd that they tried to make an alliance later, given how at odds they are earlier.
My guess is that they had obviously some separate identity, but that their relationship was probably just kind of back and forth. That at certain points, they would have friendly, what do you want to say, relationship, and then sometimes they'd have conflicts too, just like any neighbors, especially if you're essentially related, you know. But again, that's just a guess. I'm not familiar with the evidence.
To a degree, I didn't realize previously there was that much conflict, I guess, is what's surprising me. I thought they were more allies the entire time, and now I'm reading about the wars between them and stuff. It's just like, wow, I didn't really realize that.
Oh, that's really neat, Wayman. Wayman posts in the side here an example of one of the seals that they're talking about in this book. And this inscription says on the seal, belonging to Ahaz, son of Jotham, king of Judah. That's really neat. So yeah, you're starting to get stuff like this all over the place in layers from that time period. You're starting to actually get this. And this type of stuff, and along with all this other stuff I mentioned. Oh, and they talked about, too, a huge... Whereas before the fall of the Northern Kingdom, when Judah was still kind of like a backwoods, you had oil and wine production, but it seemed to be like household scale, or private production. And they're saying, too, they found evidence of major, like, I guess you could say industrial-sized, like olive oil presses and basically bigger, like state-run production of oil and wine.
Yeah, so it was.
Go ahead.
It was mentioning when the Assyrians finally just took formal control over the land, and you know they forcefully, you know, moved people around and stuff. That a lot of the people who were skilled in that wine trade, they kept there to keep the trade going.
Yeah. Yep.
I'm actually surprised that this seal that you're talking about, that Wayman posted, is... it says this is Ahaz in the 8th century. So in other words, this is before the time of Hezekiah. This is before the Assyrians came and destroyed Samaria. So it was even before that they had advanced to the point where they even had a seal, an official seal. Anyway, it seemed to indicate that they're a little bit more advanced than Finkelstein seemed to indicate.
Well, remember, Ahaz was in northern, right?
It says, belonging to Ahaz, son of Jotham, king of Judah.
Oh, that's right, yeah. And when does this date from?
He says it's the 8th century.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. Because remember, 720 when they finally wiped out Samaria.
Well, maybe I'm wrong, but I should look at the exact dating, but I was presuming that Ahaz came before Hezekiah and before that final destruction of Samaria and the northern kingdom. In other words, Finkelstein's saying it all happened. Judah was back basically almost nothing until the northern kingdom died when the Assyrians came. But this seemed to indicate, I thought maybe this was... While the northern kingdom was still thriving, and here we have an indication that Judah is already becoming something.
Yeah, let me find my king's list here. Do you guys remember that list of all the different kings?
By the way, the date that I'm seeing for him is about 731.
743 to 727, Judahite kings from Rehoboam to Ahaz. So attacked by the kings of Israel and Aram, calls Tiglath-Pileser III for help in the days of Isaiah. Pays tribute to Tiglath-Pileser III. Prosperity in the Judahite hill country begins. That's this is the extra biblical evidence. So the last line here, I don't know if you guys can read that, probably not, but that's when it's saying this is where we start getting evidence of the development of the kingdom. So remember, it's not like once we reach Josiah, that's the first like prosperous king. It's starting to develop, it sounds like, after this. Prosperity in the Judahite hill country begins. And then... makes you wonder, too, if Judah had started possibly maybe growing a little bit before the full-blown conquest of the north, like when Hazael, the Arameans had come down and started conquering Israel too. You may have had some influx of northerners into Judah during that, also, you know, and maybe that spurred some of the development of Judah also. Wouldn't surprise me.
By the way, I see Ahaz was the father of Hezekiah, so it's very... The timing is so close anyway.
Yeah, it's just we're talking a matter of a couple decades at most, so maybe whatever, 3 decades possibly. And the other thing to remember too is they probably had trading seals, you know, they weren't totally cavemen. The thing they're looking for is, like, in what layers in these tells are we getting, like, all of a sudden we're getting a bunch of these things, you know what I mean?
Right, do we see evidence of a fully functioning state, basically?
Right, yeah.
Hey, I'm sorry, Doug. I just got a quick question. What page is that king list on in the book Unearthed? Because I knew he had a king list that he had for the chronology. What page is that? Did you have it up there?
The one that I just showed up there was 236 and 237.
Oh, okay. Thanks. For some reason, I was thinking it was in the appendix in the back, and the digital copy I have, I was trying to find it. But okay, thanks.
Yeah, no problem. Yep. Yeah, and that goes from Rehoboam to Ahaz. Yeah, so.
By the way, Doug, changing the subject just a little bit, I just wanted to mention one other thing before it leaves my mind that I thought was interesting in this reading. It might actually relate to the previous chapter, chapter 8. It's on something that I've always wondered about and sometimes called the lost tribes of Israel, and it's referring to the northern 10 tribes. Basically, once they go into Assyria, and then we don't know anything about them. Like, did they survive as Jews? Do today's Jews only represent the tribe of Judah and Benjamin and Levites? You know, and then the rest are lost. But I found it interesting because the Bible makes it sound like those tribes. Like everybody, at least I always had the impression that all the entire northern kingdom were taken. But he's saying that the impression I got is that the majority were left behind, that only the elites and those that had skills that the Assyrian Empire could benefit from, you know, trained craftsmen, and the nobles and the wealthy and the royalty were taken away. So that gives me the impression that it would be wrong to even speak in terms of the lost tribes, because I would say representatives from every tribe in the northern kingdom probably, most likely, came and filtered down into the southern kingdom of Judah, and we're all together by that point.
Yeah, I don't think every member of those 10 tribes were shipped off to Babylon. I mean, even the biblical narrative, like you said, says it was mainly just nobles and skilled craftsmen, etc. And yeah, by the way, Reuven's really the guy to talk to about this stuff too.
What's interesting is once the assimilation process starts with other nations, it's insane, because when Ezra and Nehemiah come back from Babylon, the people that are left were considered outsiders. And it's crazy. It's like, hey, we're the original ones that stayed. You guys are coming back to reform the temple and to, you know, the judicial system and the whole government. And, you know, here we had to stay for 70 years. We married wives and we did the best that we could. And now you're preaching sermons at us saying, you know, we can't be a part of the community. We have to divorce our wives. And, you know, it was a really terrible acclimation process. Like, they were almost like seen as enemies in some way because of the, you know, they believed that for some reason, since they'd gone and came back, there was this falling away kind of thing, when probably the very opposite happened from influences outside of Babylon. I would think the Assyrian issue would almost be the same, you know, as far as taking on Assyrian customs and practices and a whole host of things. The people that were left there were swallowed up and forgotten, and that's one of the things that I believe Judaism is extremely afraid of, even till today. I guess in biblical terms it would be even until this day. But anyways, you know, because they're very afraid of who they're going to attract, they're very afraid of being forced assimilated or assimilated in, even, you know, through Greeks and Romans, the whole thing. And I think that is a huge fear. I don't know. If some people were left, I don't believe they would be accepted into the culture as they were, because of the fear of what they might bring with them, you know?
Mm-hmm. What's interesting, too, is it talks about even in the Bible that the Assyrians had shipped in all these foreign people to kind of repopulate a little bit in the north. It makes you wonder, like, whatever happened to them? Did they basically just merge into Israelite culture? Or
well, I thought they were the ones that Wayman is discussing. The Samaritans, basically. The Samaritans are the foreigners that the Assyrians brought into the land, and the Jews never...
He was talking about the returning Jews.
Well, the Samaritans are these foreign peoples that were settled into the northern... into Samaria, which is the capital of the northern kingdom, and this is the reason why the Jews never feel comfortable. There's always been this distinction, and Wayman was specifically talking about Ezra and Nehemiah and the building of the temple, and they wouldn't allow the Samaritans to join them in building it. It's because they weren't Jews. They were separate people. Even though they were willing to adopt the Jewish worship of Jehovah, they didn't want any part of them.
Okay. Yeah, but they were the Jews that were left. Even though they intermarried because they were told to divorce their wives if they wanted to become part of the nation in Ezra and Nehemiah.
By the way, I see that Reuben doesn't accept what I said here. He says, the Samaritans are the inheritors of the Israelite kingdom. They reject the prophets, David, and accept a new Moses.
This is what I was thinking was going on. Correct me if I'm wrong. Like, the Assyrians come in, they conquer the kingdom, they take the nobility and the skilled people. We're talking northern Israelite Jews, right? They take them to Babylon, okay? They're in Babylon. Then they ship in separate peoples, settle them, where they took away the nobility. They're living there. Then the Jews come back from exile, and as Wayman's saying, these foreign people are not wanting them to build the temple, or that the Jews who were left in Israel are not wanting the Jews coming back from exile to be involved in the building of the temple.
The Jews who came back, from Babylon to rebuild their own temple. The Samaritans wanted to join them in building the temple. This is my understanding of the Bible. But they didn't want to allow them because the Samaritans were foreigners that the Assyrians had brought into the northern kingdom. They weren't Jews, and they're saying, you have no part with us. You're not going to share in this building of our temple. I agree that there are differences between the Samaritans and the Jews, like Reuven says, but I still think these are the Samaritans we're talking about.
See, I think what we're misunderstanding is the different wars. The Assyrians is a separate war from the Babylonian takeover, right? So we're saying that the Babylonians and also the Assyrians did the same kind of pattern of removing some of the nobility and leaving commoners. So when you truck people in, the people that are integrated in with the commoners to live and to govern them, the commoners would still be part of Judaism. So what I'm saying is what happened in the case of the Babylonians was when Ezra and Nehemiah came back, the people that were left, the commoners, had intermarried with the people that were assimilated in with them. So that's why Ezra and Nehemiah said, look, if you're going to help us build a temple, you need to divorce from this other culture for us to accept you. So that's what I'm saying. That's the way I believe the Assyrians did it. They removed the nobility, left commoners, brought other people in to govern them. If they wanted to come down into Israel and live and not be assimilated into the Assyrian Empire. The only thing that we have from the lost tribes is probably the Book of Tobit. It comes from that time period, and the rest is gone. You know, they were either assimilated in. We don't know who they are.
So you're saying we don't know what happened to these foreign populations brought in?
I don't believe we do.
Okay, so it's possible, though, that they basically, like you said, intermarried and basically melded with the people left behind.
That's
the natives left behind.
Right. There's basically the only text that we have out of that time period is the Book of Tobit. And when you read that, it's far different from anything you ever read.
Are you telling me that none of you have ever heard the story that the Samaritans were brought from? They were the people relocated by the Assyrians into the land of Israel. By the way, before I let you answer that, Reuven does say that he says the genetic evidence today demonstrates conclusively that the Samaritans are Israelites. So that would argue against what I said. But anyway, I'm just curious if any of you have heard this, or am I the only one?
Well, isn't that what's in the Bible?
Yeah, that's why I thought that this accounts for the enmity in the New Testament between the Jews and Samaritans, so that Jews had nothing to do with Samaritans.
See, I think what we need to establish is, and I'm not sure of, if the Samaritans were trucked in by the Babylonians, because 70 years later, Ezra and Nehemiah come back to build the temple, and they're there, or they were trucked in by the Assyrians. It's two different wars.
Right.
I agree they're two different wars, but I don't think the Babylonians had the same practice as the Assyrians. The Babylonians did not relocate other peoples into foreign lands like the Assyrians did. Unless you can show me otherwise, the Assyrians moved foreign people into the land they never lived in before, but the Babylonians never did that.
See, I'm confused because I believe that the Babylonians started that practice.
Well,
so I could be confused myself.
If the Babylonians did it, they certainly didn't start it because the Assyrians clearly did it before.
Yeah, I very well could be confused myself on what that process was and when it all started. You know what I mean?
Well, it wouldn't be surprising.
So I don't mean to confuse everybody else, you know.
No, it's all right. It wouldn't be surprising, though, if the Babylonians basically just continued that sort of policy. You know what I mean? I mean, they weren't the only ones doing it. It was a common thing.
By the way,
Reuven's got some explanation here.
He says Wayman means the earlier Babylonians, not the later ones. So that is that what you were thinking, Wayman?
It probably is, because when Ezra and Nehemiah come back, I believe that that was before the fall of Judah. Maybe I got my history messed up.
No, yeah, the Assyrians that conquered the northern kingdom in the late 8th century, they're the ones, that's the first biblical account we have of Jews being exiled out of the north, because at that time Judah had not been attacked yet. And then it says that foreigners were moved into the north. Right, so obviously they must have been living amongst the commoners left behind, like you were talking about. And then later on, Judah basically has their own exile. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, Dale, I'm sorry I screwed that up. I just confused everybody, and I didn't know I did it.
I think I caught what you meant anyway.
But even if the original Babylonians did it, the biblical Babylonians, which are the Neo-Babylonians...
Later than Assyrians, yeah.
To my knowledge, they did not have that practice of relocating people groups. So the Babylonians, they took Israel into exile, and then at the end, they were sent back, but they were never... They didn't send anybody else into Palestine.
What we have is their claims that they are always returning peoples to lands that they had been exiled from. Whether that actually is the case or not is a flip of the coin, because some scholars would argue that those who returned from Babylon were not the same people that went. But the Bible reflecting, you know, probably Persian propaganda was saying, yes, we were from here and we're coming back.
Well, that's a good point, because this would bring up a point that Dr. Price has mentioned several times, that basically they may have said, all right, this is your original home, and here's your whole story. Basically, that the Jews were told their story, a story that they never lived and never experienced, but they just bought into it.
Yeah, and he had originally thought that they were being returned just like everybody else thought. It was only until later he read something else, and I don't know what it was, that kind of, well, I don't know if it changed his mind, but he at least accepted the possibility that the returners were not originally from Judah.
My question is whether the archaeological finds that we have with writing on them, where the changes in language, what they say about these movements of people. And for one, I don't know how different the Assyrian language was from like the language in Judah in the first place. And I don't know if the language in Israel was more similar to Judah or more similar to like Aramaic and things. I don't know. That's a good question for Reuben, but I'm just curious how tracing the different languages on different artifacts tells us how things moved.
I agree, but I see Doug writes, it seems far-fetched to me just the feasibility of doing a wholesale successful identity replacement. I agree with that. I think there's so much that we've seen that's part of the biblical story that we see authenticated in like the Tel Dan Stela, the Moabite stone, indications that the people that are part of their story that were rulers in Israel at certain points in time are reflected in the archaeological record to show there is some real history going on here, not an invented history from a people group that we then moved into the land and had them buy into. I that just seems like such a stretch to the imagination.
Well, I tend to favor the fact that they are the same people that went, that came back. But I've read arguments otherwise, and although I'm not convinced, I'm, you know, at least, you know, giving some credence to the idea, but no, personally, I favor that they're the same people that return.
Yeah, Reuben brings up a good point. I mean, too, in regards to this, like, we have genetics now, too. I mean, we can really track pretty, I mean, not definitively, but pretty, we can get a pretty good idea of, like, the genetic lineage of different people groups. So if there was some, like, major foreign influence, say between like northern Israelites and southern, that would probably show up if they had been intermixing with a different gene pool, if you will, from some other land. You know, that would be something that would show up.
Reuben, are you able to turn on your speaker and explain how you view things? I sure would appreciate it.
Reuben never talks. So that's kind of the gist of chapter 9, too. So, did you guys, any of you had anything you wanted to read, or last thoughts, or any other things in there you wanted to bring up, or really what, anything really?
Not I.
I'm really curious about, for example, Reuben says that that genetically the Samaritans are the Israelites, and I want to, and so obviously I'm curious how does that fit into history? Like exactly, at one point, who are they? When did they enter the land again? Were they never a relocated people?
Did the Bible just maintaining? Rumor maintains that the biblical account that there was even foreigners brought into Israel after the conquest by Assyria, that's biblical propaganda. That didn't happen. And that the remnants, what they call Samaritans, are just basically Israelites.
But don't we have Assyrian records testifying to that too? Not just the biblical account?
Assyrian propaganda.
So Assyrian, so two enemies, they have similar propaganda.
So, John, according to this theory, then, would you say then it's possible that the Jews never lived in Palestine or in Canaan, but that the story that was fed to this group was actual history, and they were given real names of real kings that had lived there that can be substantiated by archaeology? It's just that that wasn't them, that wasn't their story, but it was a real story.
Yeah, there was, I guess, records of it that they could reconstruct the history and write it down at some point. But the point was that in order to keep these people in line and loyal to Persia, they had to be supported by Persian force and economics and so forth. So they were sent into a land where they're automatically antagonistic to the people that were already there, the people that had remained after the Babylonian conquest. So in order to maintain their position, they had to at least pay lip service to some of the customs and religions of the people that they were now ruling over and take over some of their history, some of their customs, some of their beliefs. But the main point was to impose Persian monotheism where it had not existed before. That's the theory, anyway.
But I missed some of that. So you're not saying that the people moved from Babylon into Israel were never from Israel to begin with. You're not saying that, right?
I wouldn't say that, but that's the theory. Some people theorize that these were groups of Mesopotamian-type people is where a lot of the mythology of the Old Testament comes from, definite Mesopotamian links. Yeah. They brought that a lot of that with them because that was their original religion when they were relocated from somewhere in the Fertile Crescent, made to be rulers of a foreign land, namely Judah. And they also brought a different kind of religion. They took over, say, for instance, Yahweh from the people that lived there, made it the high god, the equivalent of Ahura Mazda, and instituted different forms of worship and centralized it in Jerusalem. That's the theory.
John, what's the best place to read this theory? Who's the best proponent of it?
You know, I really don't know who actually. I think it's multiple authors, I think.
But Reuben posted here, now that to me, if I'm interpreting it right, seems to be saying that, you know, the biblical story saying that there were foreigners brought in after the Assyrians took out the northern nobles and whatever, craftsmen. So the Samaritans today have, their Y chromosome is very tightly correlated with Jewish Y lineages, but their mitochondrial DNA seems to be more mixed with, like it says, Iraqi Jewish and Palestinian. So that's at least compatible with some foreign genetic influence coming in. But do you reject that outright, Reuben? Is that what you were saying, that the Assyrians had moved in foreigners into the northern Israelite kingdom territory? So, no, you reject it because the north was never homogenous, or no, that you don't reject it? And the North was never homogenous. You accept it. Okay. Yeah, I was wondering, because I misunderstood you earlier. I thought you didn't agree with the biblical account. Okay.
John, did you misunderstand Reuben on that point?
Must have.
Do you guys have any closing thoughts on the book so far, on the two chapters we read, or anything else?
Great stuff. I'm loving it.
I am too. Definitely. Very informative. So you guys want to take her off live, or any last thoughts? Going once, going twice? Okay, I'll take that as a no. Okay, so thanks, everybody. We'll talk after we go offline about what we're going to be reading for next week. And thanks for everybody who's here that could make it, and anybody who's watching or will watch in the future. And see you later.